Hachette Audio presents Beyond Belief, Finding the Strength to Come Back. Written by Josh Hamilton with Tim Keown. Read by Ethan Sawyer.
This book is dedicated to my beautiful wife, Katie, for your unconditional love and support. You are an amazing wife, mother, and friend. I love you. Introduction. In late January of 2006, on the spongy green grass of a former spring training stadium in Clearwater, Florida, I stood on a baseball field with a bat in my hands for the first time since I could remember. Clean and sober for more than 4 months, I was stringing together so many good days, I was starting to believe I would never have another bad one. My wife, Katie, was in the stands to watch me take batting practice that day. She had never seen me play baseball before, and all she knew of me as a ball player was my resume. Number one pick in the 1999 draft, minor league MVP, consensus choice as the best prospect in baseball. But those accolades were in the distant past, clouded by the self-destructive path my life had taken over the past 4 years. Katie and I had been married for a little more than 2 years, and in those 2 years, I hadn't swung a bat more than twice. She did not know me as a ball player. More than anything, my wife knew me as a flawed, sometimes charming, sometimes reckless, drug addict. But on this day, she sat low in the stands on the third base side of home plate to watch me take batting practice on the field with a group of 7 or 8 minor league ballplayers whose agent had brought them to Jack Russell Stadium to get some work before spring training. I was the oddball of the group, the former phenom who hadn't played for nearly 3 years, the one-time legend whose repeated suspensions for drug use had already set a major league record. I bounced around the field like a child, laughing and joking and inhaling the smell of the fresh-cut grass deep into my lungs. This must be what it feels like to be released from prison. The other players looked upon me warily, not knowing how to square my tattoo-filled body and sordid past with the giddy man standing before them. I'd regained most of the 55 pounds I'd surrendered to my crack habit, and I was trying to regain the life I lost along the way. As I prepared to hit, I looked at Katie and smiled. I was attempting to win her back, to reconcile our fractured relationship after so much disappointment and loss. I felt like I was in high school again, trying to impress a girl. The wind blew directly into the batter's box from center field, strong enough to starch the flags in center field. The first few hitters drove low liners to the gaps and deep drives that were knocked down by the wind. To a man, they walked out of the cage muttering about the wind and complaining about how tough it was to hit under those conditions. Katie was over there praying the whole time, worried that I was going to do poorly and somehow decide to give it up all over again. This was a pivotal moment when I decided to put myself out there to salvage a career I had done everything to destroy. I could tell Katie was nervous, and I smiled from behind the batting cage and mouthed the words, "Calm down, it's okay." I hit last, and after a couple of swings, I caught a groove. I was hitting balls all over the field, and more than a few over the fence. The guys milling around the cage stopped their conversations to lean on their bats and watch. This was what I used to live for, not the games or the money or anything else. I lived for the feeling I got when I stepped into the cage and everyone stopped what they were doing to watch and react. I lived to stand in that cage and pretend not to hear what they were saying when the ball rocketed off my bat and carried unimaginable distances. They whispered to each other, saying the same things I'd heard since high school. "The ball just sounds different off his bat. Did you see where that one went? This guy's amazing." It felt good to be back on a baseball field, and it felt good to be feeling good. I can't overstate the lightness it created in me to wake up with a clear conscience and go to bed the same way. Every day was progress, building my body up instead of tearing it down, and taking each day as a gift from God. It seemed like this gift, this special gift to play this game, hadn't abandoned me after all. When I finished hitting, the first thing Katie said was, "I felt sorry for those other guys." "Why is that?" I asked. "Because they're not very good." Sure they are, I said. They're all professional players. Some of those guys will be in the big leagues someday. Well, she said, completely innocent. Compared to you, they aren't very good. I turned my head and looked at her out of the corner of my eye as if to say, what'd you expect? That was the moment it dawned on her. All those things she'd heard about my ability on the baseball field, all those things pro scouts said about me when I was the number one pick in the 1999 draft, all those things that made the Tampa Bay Devil Rays give me a record $3.96 million bonus out of Athens Drive High School in Raleigh, all those things were true. They were every bit as true as the nightmares she had lived with me, her drug addict husband, ever since we got married. Her jaw dropped open for a moment as the realization struck her. I could see her running it through her head. What she had just witnessed, coupled with the torment of the past 2 years. She clenched her jaw and play-punched me in the shoulder. I'm glad I didn't know this before now, she said. If I'd have known you were throwing away that kind of talent, I would have been so much angrier with you. Chapter 1. The man watched silently, his arms crossed. He sat directly behind home plate, halfway up the concrete bleachers, a lone figure in the West Raleigh Exchange ballpark. I didn't know who he was or why he was there, but occasionally I'd catch my daddy glancing up at him from his spot on the field. They'd exchange polite nods like two men sharing a secret language. I was practicing with my brother Jason's team like I always did. The team, made up of 11 and 12-year-olds, was coached by our father, Tony Hamilton. I was 6 at the time, almost 7. I ran around shagging balls and getting a hit at the end of practice. Jason, whom I always called bro, was always encouraging to me when he probably could have told me to stay home or at least stay out of the way. The day the man sat in the stands, I made a diving catch in the outfield that nobody could believe. I was running from right center toward center field and dive until my body was parallel to the ground as I caught a ball about 6 inches off the ground. I was 6 years younger than most of the players on Jason's team, but I could do things on the field they couldn't do. I lived to play ball, and I had precocious ability from the time I picked up a ball. Bro and I would play in the yard or across the street at the cemetery, and I refused to accept our age difference as a valid reason for his superiority. I couldn't beat him. He's 4 years older than I am, and 4 years is a huge age difference for a long, long time. But I always thought I could. Whatever we played, whether it was basketball or wiffle ball, I went into every game convinced this was going to be the day. The time I spent practicing with Jason's team was my favorite time of the week. My team, at the coach pitch level, was not a challenge. When the season started, I was the typical little boy. Thrilled to put on his baseball clothes and get to the season's first practice. Once I got there, though, I was disappointed that my teammates couldn't keep up. My daddy coached my team, too, and my mama always came to our practices. After the second or third practice of my coach pitch team, once we were in the car and nobody could hear, they told me they could tell I was easing up on my throws and maybe not swinging as hard as I could when I was taking batting practice. I don't want to hurt anybody, I told them. They shook their heads. You play the way you know how to play, Daddy said. Those other boys need to get used to catching balls that are thrown hard, and if you start trying to hit the ball so it won't hurt anybody, you're going to get into bad habits that'll be hard to break. You need to be a leader, and they'll catch up. When I thought about it, I realized that Jason didn't let up on me when we were playing together, and he was 4 years older. These guys are my age, so maybe they would get better and learn to react the way I did. The next practice I threw as hard as I could, and it resulted in some missed throws and some tears. I got up there and hit the way I would if I was playing in the cemetery with Bro. My teammates kept moving back till there was nobody in the infield. The parents watching shook their heads and started talking and laughing among themselves. They'd never seen such a little person do the things I could do. As we got closer to the start of the coach pitch season, the parents started to wonder whether I could be moved up to a more advanced level. There was nothing malicious about their concern. A move would help everybody involved. They were equal parts amazed and afraid. Amazed at the speed at which I could throw the ball and the power with which I could hit it. Afraid that their less advanced sons might find themselves unprepared and in the way of one of my throws or hits. I could hear them up there, telling grandparents and friends, that kid's gonna hurt somebody. By the time I was 6, I could throw the ball about 50 miles an hour, probably twice as fast as most of the kids my age. The parents' concerns were legitimate, and they were never malicious or angry. In fact, they were very supportive of my quest to leave the team sponsored by Hamilton Machine, a business owned by my dad's cousin, and move up to play with my brother. The sooner the better, as far as they were concerned, since they believed it was just a matter of time before one of their boys lost a few teeth or got a concussion. Their fears became real in our first game, when I fielded a ball at shortstop and threw it across the infield as hard as I could to get the runner.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.